I don't think I'll ever have a perfect cup of coffee. It can exist for a moment. I say, well, I think this is best espresso I've ever tasted. After a few days, after a few weeks, you want more. And then you just keep chasing that perfection over and over again. You wake up in the morning and you just say, I love what I do. I'm not perfect at it. I'll never be. I want to make it better.
When Sasha is getting ready for comp, he doesn't eat, he doesn't sleep, he doesn't do anything but coffee.
You could hear him practicing his speech.
The last 4 years as a barista and a coffee buyer, first sip, it's all about the creamy mouthfeel.
The amount of training he went through, that was insane.
Now I need to stop talking to everyone for 2 hours so I can have my voice.
Back to the 2015 World Barista Championships here in Seattle. It was with great pleasure I announced the next competitor, Mr. Sasha Sestic!
We are in Ethiopia, and we're going to do some cupping. Cupping is wine tasting for coffee.
I've tasted this coffee 6 years ago, first time, and I've tasted blueberries and raspberries and blackcurrants.
Yeah, it made me crazy. It made me fly to Melbourne in a coffee shop that was serving that coffee just to taste it again. I said, well, it was blueberries. Suddenly coffee didn't taste bitter anymore, and first time in life tasted fruity and got me obsessed with it. Last year I found one of these coffee trees and I just gave it a big kiss and big hug. Yeah. Amazing apricots and honey. Now, I must say, this is one of the most intense coffee trips I've ever done, being in Ethiopia for 10 days. You spend about eight and a half hours in the car every single day. The driver needs to concentrate, like there's animals coming out. People are like just on the side of the road, literally half a meter from the car. We even saw a tornado. Locals call them dust devils. Let's go in the forest, huh? I'm looking for cherries. That's where coffee beans come from. But I want to find some really nice red ones. So what you do is just open it up here a little bit, mm-hmm. and just suck it in and try to collect as much juice as possible. And that slimy stuff there, that's mucilage, that's sweetness in the coffee. Good indication to see when cherries are ready to be picked, you want to see 2 to 3 drips. Three. Yeah. I was looking forward to come here for last year and a half and meet people behind the scene and why their coffee is tasting as nice as it is.
Very beautiful. Very big as well.
Yeah.
Can you look at taking some samples of them?
Yeah.
I have not seen this before in Ethiopia. They've done an amazing job picking at this farm. We expect some really nice fruity floral flavors out of these big cherries. I'm like a kid in a lolly shop holding his lollies, super excited. My wife is gonna kill me. I promised I'm gonna buy only one, but looks like I'm gonna end up with three containers from Ethiopia. Shit. You can spell raisins, hey? We've changed hotels, regions, every second day as well. 12 hours in a car, in a very awkward position. It wasn't fun. Sometimes I think coffee is not worth this pain. Plus, we've been able to cup 200 to 300 coffees. So Bonga is sort of there, yeah?
Yes. Bonga is around here, it may be.
So we're going there? We're going to Bonga because I've heard of these wild coffee trees in Gesha Forest. Few people have seen them. What's the plan? Like, I would really love to see wild coffee. If people want to chill out and I need to jump in a car and go, like, I have to see wild coffee while I'm in Ethiopia.
Jump in a car.
Yeah, or we're going to go and walk and machete or whatever we need to do.
Half an hour, he can sit on the tractor.
I can sit on the tractor for 2 hours.
We can all
hours.
Sit.
I don't care. Yeah.
Have a seat here.
I think we were sitting at the back of the old tractor and just going through the entire forest. We've got a guard with a rifle in case of lions. Then we spotted some of the really wild trees, untouched. It's a virgin forest. Not red.
Oh, yeah.
So it's pretty close, but that's not it. We've come at the wrong time of the year and cherries are overripe and old. And that made me feel very unhappy and a little bit depressed. It's impossible for us to find the cherry now.
Yes, it's impossible. It's impossible.
It's very rare to find it. It's a wild, it's a natural coffee tree and it would be awesome to have a sample of that and collect the seeds and see what it tastes like, and if it tastes good, try to spread it throughout the world. I'm gonna go home now, I'm pissed. The tractor is broken down, so it looks like it's gonna be a nice long walk for us. Going up and up. We were going back from a forest. We heard a noise and there was this group of people just coming towards to us singing, dressed in all these awesome colors. They had this really cool special dance. And I thought I can do this. So I joined them. We are in Canberra, capital city of Australia. And this is my favorite part. There's really nice restaurants in there. This is where I've done my hospitality diploma, and this is where I made my very first coffee. We were sort of putting a lot of froth on cappuccinos. These days we would call them mountain chinos. It takes time to get used to this place because it's really quiet. But in Canberra is where I met my wife. Is where I had my kids. My parents live here. And in Canberra is when I got opportunity to fulfill my dream, my vision for specialty coffee.
He's very obsessed with coffee. His coffee vocabulary is better than his actual vocabulary most of the time.
Looking at my odd accent, people would know, you know, well, you're not even from Canberra. No, I'm not, you know. I was born in Banja Luka, which is in Bosnia. Completely different than what my kids grew up in Australia. Of course, computers did not exist and video games. I had my little gang where I was a leader of my little pack.
All day in the street, kids is out on the play, basketball, soccer, handball, I don't know.
I'd try to bring people who can play in a team as well, and let's play now soccer, or next month we're going to play athletics.
My wife go behind him and put him food in mouth, and he didn't have time to go in the house to eat normal.
So I would have probably all of my meals outside.
Any kind of brother or relationship that are 4 years apart, there was a lot of fighting. All initiated by him.
When he was a child, he always made any trouble.
My grandma, for example, would keep her eggs on a balcony outside, and I'll just get the eggs and I'll see postman on a bike, and I'll just, you know, chuck some eggs on him as well, and I was creative, eh?
Troublemaker.
Look, he was always full of love for me and parents and everyone, but it was just a little bit too much energy.
Never stop. He think he can go through the world.
And then war started in Slovenia and Croatia. I remember being a kid, like we had no electricity for six, seven, eight months. There's this army aeroplanes going above you 10 meters, and you'd sort of need to go to the ground because they're so noisy. Everyday scenery was tanks and soldiers and bombs. I did not really want to take a part of any of the sides because my mom's side is Muslim and my dad's side is Orthodox. So we moved to Serbia. We were lucky enough that my brother was very good handball player. Handball is very big in Europe. It's non-stop, it's very physical. There's a lot of body-to-body contact.
And I always pulled my brother with me, and you know, he was always joined to our senior team, our professional teams.
And we wanted to be best sports people we possibly could, the best handball players. But then political situation in Serbia was getting worse and worse. We finally decided that we need to leave.
At that time, we couldn't wait to get out.
We're moving in Australia February 1996.
I think that Sydney 2000 Olympic Games, that was very tempting for us. It's a dream of any sportsman to be part of Olympic Games. And we managed to get a visa.
When we arrived in Melbourne, it was a different planet for us. All you think, how do I fit here? It was hard. We didn't have skill to work, to support us, neither my parents did.
Our biggest problem when we came to Australia was just English. We didn't know one English word.
My parents have decided from Melbourne to move to Canberra. We have a family relative that has decided to help them out, providing a house. For me, Canberra worked very well because we had Australian Institute of Sport. So whenever Australian handball team was doing the camps, everything was done in Canberra. So Canberra was no-brainer for me to come.
Sasa's tried that now signature leap.
At the time, I was convinced that all my life I'm going to be a professional handball player, and that's the only thing that mattered to me.
Sasa was always more agile. I think his vertical leap was 1.10 meters, which is insane.
3 months before Sydney Olympic Games, I was voted as best player in Australia.
Do you know why he's the best?
Why?
Check this. Okay.
I was youngest handball player in the entire Olympic Games, being only 21, 22 years old. But no manager approached me after Sydney 2000. Yeah, I was a little bit lost for a couple of years. Did not know what to do and where to go and what to look for. So I've decided we should buy one of the Hansel and Gretel cafe chocolate shops in Canberra.
Sasa came up with an idea. How about we buy this? A bakery, Italian bakery, where they bake bread, cakes, everything from scratch. And I said, Sasa, that's ridiculous. Like, who's going to make the bread?
Well, I've told Betty that I want to learn how to bake cakes and bread, and I wanted to have Dragan and Maria to come and join us in the business.
Spoke to Dragan, he goes, do you want to go in or you don't want to go in?
I didn't want to, I was against it.
So it was kind of like that, Sasha's way, very quickly, I'm done.
It was really small, tiny cafe that sell chocolates and made about 50 coffees a day. And we were proud when we made 100 coffees a day.
So we had no experience at all and we just started making cappuccinos, flat whites, and different coffees without actually knowing how to make them.
Neither we drank coffee at the time. None of us, Sasa as well.
My coffee was tasting bitter. Obviously, at the time, I thought that it's not problem with the coffee, it's problem with coffee that we're serving in the company, and we need to do something about it. The big leap forward was our trip to Sydney. We checked out specialty coffee booth at a food show.
It was nothing like we had. It was nothing like we were making or drinking.
Tasting some delicious coffees there, I've actually realized that there's lots of skill into not just making coffee, but also roasting coffee.
I remember Mum and Dad telling me that in our old house, that's where he started roasting coffee. And then from there, he moved on to a little garage. And that's when Sam came along. And then he started roasting coffee for us.
First time I hated him, I thought the guy was a jerk. he came into a comp and he stole my grinder and all my stuff. He had no gear and ended up beating me. At least he's going to let me keep some of the coffee I can run at work. And he basically even like scraped every single bean out. I was like, thanks for your grinder. I'll come and see you in a week, and didn't come and see me for 4 months.
We work very long hours, but what's amazing is when I see Sam starting roasting at 6 o'clock in the morning and he's still roasting till 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and you talk to him and he loves what he does.
Sasa, head of a good frame of the crew. Angus, Gus was a big part of it back then. He was tall, shy, very polite kid with very messy shoes and pants.
He wanted to fire me, actually. I was pretty bad because I was young and just really nervous and naive, and he just kind of had enough, but managed to kind of stick it out. It has been actually pretty amazing to see it grow to a roastery with 3 coffee roasters, shops all around Canberra.
So my first competition in coffee was, 2008.
It was very, very scary because Sasha didn't have much knowledge at the time. There was nobody to teach him. And he bit the bullet and he says, all right, I'm going to compete.
Every time I smell this drink, it reminds me of farming.
God, he was not a very good performer and his shirts were even worse.
He had this one that was like a picnic table. It was really bright.
But he took the comp like a duck to water.
The way I look at a coffee, it's very similar to sport.
He's very competitive. Even just when we would play soccer or anything, he would make sure that he sort of lets me win, but only just because he didn't want to make it too big of a difference.
I was not a big fan of my coffee from supply at the time, so I decided to do my own research and to learn where coffee comes from and how do we actually get that best possible coffee in a cup.
Have you ever wondered how coffee ends up in your cup? My dad did. The first thing he learned is that it all starts with the bean. But did you know that coffee beans are actually seeds? It's true. The seeds grow inside cherries. Yep, cherries. You can eat them and everything. Coffee trees are usually planted on the sides of mountains in countries close to the equator. Each cup of coffee can taste really different. And that's because it depends on how you process the beans. When I asked Dad about this, it took him 2 hours to explain it. But here's the short version. There are three main ways to process coffee. Natural processed coffees are dried with the whole fruit left on them. While they dry, the beans absorb fruit flavors, intensifying body and sweetness. Washed processed coffees have the skin and pulp stripped from the cherry before they're washed. This increases clarity and acidity, usually creating more refined flavors in the cup. Finally, honey processed coffees have the skin stripped away, but the pulp is left on while they dry. It brings out body and sweetness. Plus, it improves the acidity and flavor. After processing, the beans are milled to remove the husk. The best coffee is then sorted by hand before it's exported. And finally, a barista grinds them up, adds hot water, and there's your cup of coffee. Everything makes sense? Now you're a coffee nerd, like my dad.
So I travel a lot around the world sourcing coffee.
Sasha told us we were going to Central America with a bunch of coffee people to visit all these farms, and first stop was Honduras. So there aren't many direct flights to these countries, so there was a lot of stops in airports on the way.
It was Dragon's first trip to coffee region. And he hates flying.
That was such a long plane ride to get to Honduras. We were all so tired when we got to Honduras, except for Sash. He was so excited. Sasha's luggage all got lost, but for once it wasn't his fault.
Can we borrow some underpants?
I'll need your toothbrush as well.
Honduras is a very poor country. There's not much infrastructure. You can see there's not much money, streets, public spaces, nothing is like back home. They're doing it hard. So every 50 person is involved in some way with coffee, the farmer or son of a farmer or...
So we all got to Jorge's place. He's an old friend of Sasha's. There was no stuffing around at all because Sasha wanted to get to the farms as soon as possible.
Okay, after asking how you are, it's good to see you, but after that, after all the greetings, when we are going to the farm?
Enjoy, San Pedro.
For us, the roads are okay, but if you are a stranger, you can find those roads very difficult and very dangerous.
Altitudes. Yeah, but praying not to throw up.
oh, oh my God, oh, all the time, all the road.
It's holding for my life.
Okay. This is gonna be extreme dragon now.
Should I walk?
If you had a problem with this, you definitely need to walk because this is fun. You wanna sit in the back?
Yeah?
Yeah, let's go. Okay.
So that's think about it down the bottom.
Oh, thank God. Look out. Bojok, oni kad kupe, i onda se kombinju dođe popodne. Odmah iz mog
backyard. Oh, it's my dad.
He has fallen in love with Honduras. Honduras is just, I don't know how many steps above everybody else in his book. It was way different to any of us expected. It's not actually rows and rows of coffee, and you go in a casual mode and pick. It's quite a bit of a rock climbing operation to get those beans.
Hay que estar bien almorzado para subir a esa montaña, porque es a pie.
See how crazy is this? On one tree, you're gonna have like little buds ready to start flowering. You have green beans.
It might make your view of the lake shit.
And you also have ripe cherries, like here.
It's quite here still on the tree.
We're gonna go so high that we're gonna tickle Jesus' feet.
Bueno, ese día que Sasa vino, era un mes de febrero de 2014. Se nos ocurrió ir a hacer una caminata y le dije que le iba a enseñar un lugar que le iba a interesar mucho.
Jorge took me at the top of the mountain to show me his view of his farm.
My dad started to talk with Sasha. He gets very excited with all his ideas, his vision, his dreams.
As we were climbing up, he was sort of telling me, the farm, it's big, I haven't planted much, but there's a little bit of this stuff here, a bit of this stuff there. It's hard to grow it quickly, and there's no finances and the funds, and I don't know if there's a buyer, that if I plant everything, if buyers are gonna come and buy these coffees. And then he kept walking, and then I said, wow, look at this. I think I can help him to bring buyers and promote this coffee worldwide, and I'd love to be part of this community. I'd love to have a farm here.
That was the moment. That was the moment when he decided that was the right decision to be part of this community.
Yep. And then we just kept talking of these insane ideas that maybe Aussie guys should own a farm in us.
I feel that Betty was like a worry about that Sasha was doing such kind of things.
So I said, well, if I possibly call this farm same name as my wife, which is Betty, she might not hate me so much. Yeah, so I came home, I said, hey, I bought a farm.
It definitely wasn't a normal conversation, like, oh, you know, this is what's happening, there's this place, it's a good opportunity, nothing like that. It was like, yeah, how was your day? What's happening? Ta-da-da. Oh, by the way, yeah, we bought a farm. And then he continued on to something else.
And I kind of wanted to give her a couple seconds because I knew his first instant reaction is like, come on, like, this is a bad idea. Are you normal? Like, what are you doing? You're buying a farm in Honduras?
So he said, oh, but you know what? I've named it Finca Betty, so I've named it after you. And I'm thinking, gosh.
So she had a few tears. She wasn't as mad at me anymore.
Look, it's a great thing. It's nice to have a farm and it helps him with his experiments and developing more and stuff.
He's saying you would have to dig your own.
Thanks, mate.
My wife would be proud of me.
Yeah, exactly.
I might drink this in 5 years' time. It's going to be delicious.
So now we're flying to Colombia to hunt for that perfect coffee that I want to use for my barista competition.
and I always love coming to Colombia.
I worry a lot. I talk to people and I say, oh, Sasha's in Colombia. Everybody's like, oh my God, Colombia. Not the safest place in the world.
It was kind of weird. There were like five cops with their guns and everything. Something dangerous had happened, or there were some dangerous people they were looking for or something. They came in like in the hall watching us all cut. They're like, oh yeah, it's just for your safety. And it's sort of, what? We need safety while we're in this hall cupping? I bet Sash didn't even see the cops.
I didn't notice cops until we actually left.
Sasha was telling me how they need to go from one place to another place, and instead of driving, which could have taken about 2.5 to 3 hours, they were driving to a completely different place and then catching a flight. They traveled the whole day just so they can avoid the guerrillas.
There was a lot of troubles, you know. Colombia went through almost civil war just back in the 90s with guerrilla and everything.
You just need to walk around them, and I've never had any problems.
Going to Camilo's farm, he had this crazy setups of irrigation and different methods of processing and plants and this and that.
This is a geisha.
Camilo told me he's got this very different processing method, and that got me very excited and inspired. Camilo told me, yes, we've done this experiment with sort of small natural processed coffee in a stainless containers, and I said, oh, this is insane. You know, that's something that's been in my head, and that's obviously something that's been in his head for a long time, and so, well, let's do something with it. I just loved how he thinks about coffee. I possibly wanted to work with him on my barista comp for next year. I've selected Sudan Rumé because I've seen very high potential in that coffee to be amazing espresso.
Because, you know, when you talk to people and you say Sudan Rumé, they say, what? I mean, they don't actually know anything about it.
Yeah, it's like no other coffee I've tasted, that's for sure. This coffee has been grown and processed at Las Nubes on Camilo's farm. The method's called washed carbonic maceration.
Washed carbonic maceration. It's a bit of a mouthful, isn't it? Remember when we talked about the three ways to process coffee? Well, washed carbonic maceration is similar to a washed processed coffee, but different. After the coffee cherries are picked, they're washed and sealed inside a stainless steel container. And carbon dioxide is pumped in to remove all the oxygen. Then, the container is kept at exactly the right temperature while the beans macerate. And finally, the beans are dried in greenhouses, where the temperature and humidity are carefully controlled. But why is it so complicated? I'll tell you. For years, Dad's been on a mission to find the perfect coffee. And processing the beans like this means that all the good stuff gets locked in the tank while the beans macerate. That means the coffee has more distinct flavors. It's also easier to make the coffee taste the same each time because the beans are protected from the weather. So that's washed carbonic maceration. Still slightly easier to say than single origin double shot soy long macchiato.
Can you manage it?
I've decided to use Sudan Rumé for my barista competition. It's time to take it home, taste it with my team, cup the coffee, and use it for my national barista competition. Hidenori Izaki is a World Barista Champion 2014.
Hidenori Izaki!
He won WBC in Rimini in Italy. it was amazing to have him taste my competition coffee. We had a cupping session, and then after talking for a few days, we've learned that we share a lot of similarities, a lot of same values.
I found, you know, it's called Dal and nectarines and peach, and I saw this is natural process.
But then when it cools down, it turns into raisins and ports and like winey or maybe brandy characters.
He knows a lot of things about the coffee, and I taste it. Boom. Flavors like exploding, you know, such a nice coffee.
Is it clean?
It's so crumbling. No. No, super clean, yeah, honestly.
He's like a kid. He's like a kid, he loves coffee. He's like basically keep asking me a lot of questions, you know, why, how do I become better?
What is it that you don't like about it?
If it's going to be espresso, it's going to be disaster.
I sort of thought, like, he's perfect. I think within 6 or 7 days, we've sort of decided that Hide will be coaching me.
So this is Sasha's 7th time doing Australian Barista Comp. But this time he had Hide with him, so it was a completely different mindset. It was really cool.
Barista competitions. They actually do exist. They're basically the Olympic Games, but for baristas. You might find it a bit confusing, but don't worry, I'm here to help. Okay, in a competition you've got 15 minutes to make and serve 3 sets of 3 different coffees. An espresso, a milk-based coffee, and a signature drink. With the signature one, you have to combine the coffee with other ingredients to make the coffee taste extra delicious. For each drink, you get to choose your own beans. Dad loves this bit. A good routine shows off where the coffee comes from, the story of why it's so special, and exactly what each drink is going to taste like. Competitions need judges, and barista competitions have heaps. Before the start of your routine, this huge group of judges walks on stage. You have to serve coffees to 4 of them. They're the ones you talk to about your coffee. Then there's 2 that check every move you make, and 1 more that keeps an eye on everything. It looks pretty intense. My dad says the most important thing is to have amazing coffee, and that the coffee tastes exactly the way you say it will. There are 3 rounds, and if you want to win, then you have to get everything right each time. Whoever has the best coffees and the best routine ends up being the champion. Barista competitions, they really do exist.
Nationals was interesting for us because we knew that our coffee was good. We knew it was exciting, but it's hard to have faith in something when every time you've gone confident down, you've just been off the mark. But this year he was being coached by Hidenori. I guess it was like a secret weapon, bit of extra backup.
Coach is very important. Someone that brings some synergy into the team. I was checking about every single details, like how you interact with the judges. You know, for example, giving eye contact and smile is very important.
Exactly. So when the customer's coming to your shop, exactly, from the gate, exactly, you give a smile. Welcome.
Exactly.
That's the point.
And the amount of training he went through, that was insane. It's crazy. He will call me at 10, 11 p.m. and talk about the flavors, and I'm falling asleep listening about it.
You've got to remember, this guy's an ex-Olympian. So he's focused on training, being regimented in doing things, and you know, lots of energy goes into his performance. He's extremely passionate about what he does. That's Sasha. I was so upset last year when he stuffed up his drinks in the final round, his signature drinks.
That particularly I wanted to dedicate my barista comp to people in Honduras. Gerardo, he was a manager, and he was managing the farm when we were doing a very interesting project back in 2014. We've sort of improved coffee right from the soil. I was involved in a picking process at a farm. I was involved in fermentation techniques. At the time, it was priceless because I've done everything with my hands, from the soil to a cup. I've even roasted my own coffee that year as well.
He was one-man band. He did everything himself, didn't have a coach, didn't let anyone help him out. He didn't trust anyone.
I think sometimes when you do things on your own, sooner or later there will be this big, terrible mistake that will eventually happen.
I was watching the presentation, but I had no idea what was happening. When everything finished, Sasha goes, "Oh, did you film it?" And I said, "Yeah, you were great." Sam said he was great.
He'd come third the year before, so I think he was almost expected to maybe win.
Everybody was absolutely sure about the fact that he would have won easily because he was much better than anybody else.
Remember three people, like, he stuffed up, and like, no, he didn't stuff up. He was perfect, he was amazing, he's got it.
He goes, "I'm not sure, let me watch the video." And so he watched the end part and he was like, "Oh."
When we look at it, it's such a silly little mistake which should not happen.
No one was watching his actions. All we're doing is watching him speak, and he wasn't watching his own actions.
I was watching him. I didn't notice him putting the same drink in the same cups twice. And then I counted him through
several times. I didn't believe that he had possibly mixed them up.
And it wasn't until we went backstage and, you know, the remnants of his drinks, tasting them, and it hit me. And he was like, maybe the judges didn't notice.
Everyone saw.
So two judges will have intensely sweet espresso, intensely sweet signature drink, and the other two judges will have espresso as a signature drink. So that was the year he lost.
I was pretty depressed.
I didn't see him for hours. I think he disappeared, and he was really rattled by that.
Yeah.
This was another incredibly close competition. These guys are all very experienced.
Before announcement, I knew I failed.
But I've never seen him that broken, very flat. It was hard night ahead and hard day driving back to Canberra.
After a while, Jorge Lanza called me, and I thought he just wanted to make me feel a little bit better about, you know, how poorly I've done. But then he told me, "Sasha, I have some really bad news."
The person that is in charge of the farm was killed. So we are really in shock.
He said Gerardo was murdered. Yeah, he left two beautiful boys behind and his wife. And while I was serving Gerardo's coffee, yeah, he probably got murdered in that same time, so it's a bit.
He would not talk to anyone, and you can see that he's always somewhere else, very distant.
I think there was a good period where he just wasn't the same. It took him a long time to come around to, even the thought of competing to him was something that he was ready to give up.
I had no idea what I wanted to do with the comps. Deep in me, yes, I wanted to go. I did want to go another year because that sort of gave me an extra strength and another reason. If I go and compete, what do I want to talk about? You know, that relationship between the farmers and consumers, that's to me most important in this entire coffee chain.
He needed what happened in 2014 to make him realize that it's not just about how you speak, it's about everything, it's about being in control and really focus and want to not make any mistakes, just be perfect. And I think it really showed in what he did the following year.
He was able to recharge the battery and say, "Fuck, no, next year I'll make it much better and I'm gonna win."
Now I have opportunity to improve this coffee even further without going back to the farm. So I'm going to highlight sweetness, texture and flavor by using techniques and also ingredients to to give you a new experience from my espresso. Thank you.
He did well, but then again, you don't taste coffees. So you're just watching for mistakes. You can see technical mistake, maybe, or you can see really bad mistake, obviously. Then you watch other guys and you go, wow, wow, wow. Well, you know, it's quite impressive in finals.
And these stunning coffees were perfectly roasted by barista champion James Mercedes.
Sasha and I were both in the finals and really hoping one of us would win.
Craig Simon.
Sasha was looking good to be in the top three.
Sasha Sestich and Matt Perger in third place. Matt Perger!
Yeah, they usually go, you know, third, second.
In second place, Craig Simon!
At that moment, we knew that's it.
Barista champion, Sasha Sestich!
Winning Australia was something we've always dreamed of. It meant that he'd represent Australia in the World Barista Comp in Seattle. We were travelling in less than 4 weeks after he won.
It feels sort of like everything's about to go pretty crazy.
Once we got back, it was straight back into roasting coffee, straight back into rehearsal. There wasn't any time to sit in and really absorb what had happened.
From, let's say, 6 o'clock in the morning, he would go to the roastery and practice.
As a coffee buyer, I've met so many wonderful producers.
He lost a lot of weight. It was a bit scary. He was just drinking coffee the whole time and he was quite stressed.
But he was really focused, like, as Hira was advising me, I needed to have entire team. Like,
we cannot talk about the Sasa Sestich without talking Kelly, Sam, John Gordon.
It's a team effort. It's not a one-man show.
It's about 8:30 at night and I've just finished packaging Sasha's espresso and I realised that there's more espresso and there's more espresso and there's more. And more, and more, and more, and even more.
There's a million logistics. Yeah, it's a nightmare.
The amount of stuff is just insane. Just think of 16 bloody suitcases worth of stuff. Some of them weren't even suitcases. Some of them were just Kelly and Sash taping foam around metal objects.
8 sets of scales, and we still ended up buying 2 sets of scales over there.
2 trolleys. You didn't just bring 1 trolley, you brought 2 trolleys.
Wine glasses, 2 sets of them. Those pouring jugs for the signature drink, I think 3 of them.
He would have had 4 Bunsen burners.
Little Allen keys, we had screwdrivers, probably had 3 toothbrushes to clean grinders.
We had these little bottles with the grape maceration and the plum reduction, which are for his signature drink.
We had like 150, 160 kilograms of coffee ready to go. We've calculated that we can take only, I think, about 80 kilograms of coffee, which was very tough. Sydney Airport was fun because we started going to coffee shops, getting guys.
All the reductions, the grape macerations, if we let that get too warm, it'd start fermenting. So we had to keep that on ice in thermoses.
We divvied it up into our little 50 gram bottles and then stashed them through everyone's bags. The security cameras would have been wondering, what are these people doing? It was risky, but I'm sure the last ones were in his pants, tucked away safely, just in case. He was getting that on the plane no matter what.
Some guy in customs at LA pulls out a plum reduction, like plum and panela reduction. And he's pulled out this little like travel bottle and he's like, what the hell is this? And I'm like, plums for my face.
But we just breeze through, high five the custom guy.
The ones that travelled upstairs have got a slightly better aroma than the ones that are.
Oh, yeah.
Everything that we did to keep the plum reduction and the great maceration cold was worth it.
All the way from Australia to Seattle, so far so good.
Top shot.
The grinder, no wonder you're having issues.
I didn't have issues.
I do not believe you cleaned this.
I did, for sure.
You did not clean this. You absolutely did not.
The amount of money we spent on wood is just ridiculous.
Much more better.
Should we close that door in case housekeeping goes past and I'm furnishing shul?
I believe that relationship between a farmer and consumer plays new but very important role in specialty coffee chain. And my inspiration to work with Camilo is because I, as a barista, want to serve you an amazing coffee.
If you made any mistake and you cannot talk, just pretend it to be normal.
Yeah.
Right? That gives bad impression for the judges.
Yeah.
It was very lucky that we'd been involved with Hide and he'd done this already before.
Obviously, you've got confused and upset. You, if you spill or if you like, you're fucked up or whatever, on the over there or like, or the, in front of the machine, and just be normal. Yeah. Don't talk. Right? So if you keep talking like this, you're gonna be talking when you make a mistake in the station. Right? So just be calm and be usual, right?
Can we do a full presentation again? Or yeah. You just wanna have signature drink to taste?
We can do the whole presentation, what you prefer.
Yeah.
And Sasha, just keep your tempo, right? Be conscious about your tone of your voice.
Would you like to see more?
I want to see if what happens if we extract a little bit more.
That last little bit in the cups on Brenna.
We were trying all these different milks that we bought from the supermarket.
None of them worked.
Some tasted a bit like hay. We even have one that tasted like fish oil capsules.
It tastes like fish. We had convinced Sash that we're going to find something that's just as good as Australian milk. Like, this is what every other competitor is doing, the same thing, let's try it all.
Everyone said, you don't need a milk, like that milk is probably going to be better than what we have in Australia. But me being me, a little bit stubborn, and I said, no, milk is going with us.
I am Sasha's milk mule. You know, it could be worse, at least I'm not his drug mule. You know, I could, and I don't have to put it in an uncomfortable place or anything, I just have to put it in my luggage.
We decided to fly Mr. Roland a couple days after us.
So that he can have milk that's one day fresher, so that when he makes it, hopefully in the finals, he's got, you know, the best milk he can possibly have.
This is like the freshest strike.
Expiry is the 21st.
Okay.
Not really your standard package.
Fingers crossed I don't get caught.
So I'm in the airport and I was umming and ahhing. I'm like, oh, do I tick the box that says I have something to declare? Do I not? So I walk up to the guy and, you know, do you have anything to declare, sir? And I was like, oh, yeah. Yeah, I've got some milk. He's like, milk? I'm like, yeah. He's like, oh, okay.
Got a message, hey, he's gone through custom, he's safe. We all just started hugging each other.
I definitely remember him kissing me.
So yes, we're going to have that raspberry candy tasting coffee again, hopefully. These 6 liters of milk were most precious 6 liters of milk in my life, and they will ever be most precious 3 bottles of milk. I think it's good to relax, chill out, and have a awesome day tomorrow.
So there's four bananas, and I can eat more. Sasha's in a good mood. If you can give the great impression to the judges in the round one, it's gonna be great. All right, good?
My usual routine with Hire was, we sort of hide somewhere from everyone. An hour before routine, we sort of went to loading dock. I started shaking his hand like he's my judge. And then I called time and I started, you know, explaining my routine. And I've just gone blank.
I can control my nervousness by myself. It's easy, but I cannot control his nervousness.
I've completely lost not only what I need to say, but what I need to do. And then I started sweating and panicking, getting pale. So this is no good.
He got upset, so I don't have to handle him.
He goes, wow, can he pull this off?
So at the end of the day, we will be announcing our 12 semifinalists.
All up there were 52 competitors from, you know, 52 different countries around the world.
The barista champion of Mexico, everyone, Julieta Vasquez Rivera.
She was very nervous. And I'm always worried when they, you know, serve the espresso and they're putting it down on the judge's plate and you can hear the clatter. I'm like, hope they don't spill it.
Thank you very much.
A round of applause for the barista champion of Mexico!
Maxwell from the UK just got this like this huge block of ice and he had these little holes drilled in to keep his little flavour things for his signature drink cold. He was definitely one of the stronger competitors.
My name is Don Chan and I'm come from Kampeng Group.
So the guy from Hong Kong, he's busted out for his signature drink. He's got like the dry ice, liquid nitrogen. So he's gone the full like science experiment and there's like, you know, smoke bubbling out of it. It looked amazing.
Okay, who's it first, please?
So I was watching the Korean competitor and I was really interested to see how he went because I knew beforehand he didn't speak any English and he had memorized his script.
I'm going to use red katai and red honey process.
So he was doing quite well, all until this point, right at the end, when one of the judges said, you know, you've got 1 minute left. And he turns back and you can just see it's just gone. And then in the end, he's just like, oh, sorry, that's the end of my presentation. Oh. Like backstage, you could see he was just shattered. Yeah, heartbreaking.
And then Sasha came in with his performance.
The barista champion of Australia, everyone. Big round of applause for Sasha Sestich.
I don't want to be near Sasha, I'm more nervous than he is.
I'm just watching everything he does very closely.
Didn't sleep last night.
Doing the two-step nervous.
You good to go?
Beautiful.
Time. It is really good to be here with you today. In the last 4 years, as a barista and a coffee buyer, I've met so many wonderful producers. And together, we share the ideas and experiments to help improve quality.
I think he looked a little bit flustered when he was doing his setup.
It was not convincingly jumping out.
So guys, in these booklets in the front, you'll see information on Camilo, about Camilo and the farm. These booklets are for you to keep, so please, after presentation, take them back with you. I'm going to start with the signature shots, but once again, welcome.
I remember him speaking really fast.
we're just like, slow down, you're moving too fast. And he looked rushed and fast hand movements, all this stuff.
So technical judges, I am going to use my distributing tool today.
The hardest part about being there was having the blooming possibility that you're going to put all this effort in and day one you'd go home.
Now, I'm just going to cool down these signature shots, but for now, can you please turn over to page number one in your booklet? And you will see that processing is very unique.
Being emotionally involved, you hope. You don't look at it rationally, you know, you just want him to go through the first round.
So when I combine this milk with my espresso, you're going to get very creamy mouthfeel, amazing raspberries, and the hint of caramel. And that's my time. Thank you very much.
Please give it up for the barista champion of Australia, Mr. Sasa Sestic!
20%. You need 80% more.
We all get a day for an announcement of the top 12 semi-final.
All right, are we ready to do this?
Yes.
All right.
Our first semi-finalist tomorrow in the 2015 World Barista Championship is the barista champion of the Czech Republic, Adam Neubauer.
The niggling feeling the whole time is we're not good enough to be here. Coffee's not good enough, we're it too inexperienced. You're competing against the best in the world.
John Ryan Singh.
That was ridiculous, because we weren't completely happy with the first run through. They're calling out all these names and we're just like, oh God, like, he's serious? He's gonna get bowled out in the first round.
The country of Hong Kong, the cupping room.
It wasn't said, but you could feel it. If Australian competitor doesn't make top 12, it's a little bit disappointing, you know, going back home.
The barista champion of Norway, Alexander Hansen.
Two spots, one of them goes through, Sasha is still standing there. And one last spot left, there was another, those two solid competitors with Sasha standing on the side. And
we were just like, oh, come on, like.
And I said, this is it, you know, it's time to go home.
One last final competitor. Thank you. In some order, representing the country of Australia, Sasha Sestic.
Oh, it was crazy, jumping out all over the place.
It was hard because we wanted to be excited about it and he wanted to be excited, but I don't know if everyone knew, he was really unwell.
I wanted to hide myself because I had no power to talk to anyone.
When Sasha is getting ready for comp, he doesn't eat, he doesn't drink, he doesn't sleep, he doesn't do anything but coffee. I'm not sure whether he was aware how exhausted he was.
We wanted to celebrate, but he was so sick he had to pretty much go back straight to the hotel room.
I think he was running on adrenaline. And he said, we have to go to the hospital. And it's like 5-6 minutes walk. So I said, can you walk for 5-6 minutes?
I couldn't walk. So I was pretty much sitting or lying down while Betty was finding a taxi for me. We jumped in a taxi.
We went to the hospital. That's when he kind of got absolutely exhausted. He couldn't talk.
The temperature was 39.6, low blood pressure, chest infection, virus. They were really worried about my heart conditions.
They gave him, I think, two bottles, full bottles, through a drip.
And I kind of pulled Betty's arm and I said, Betty, just
tell them what's happening tomorrow. Tell them to get it fixed. Ask them to give me some more of this, whatever this is. And I knew that he was going to go and do the semi-finals the next day, even though he couldn't literally walk. So he was just finding a way to explain to these people in the hospital, please get him on his two legs.
And all night she was waking up every 40 minutes and an hour, giving me different antibiotics and all these different medications I needed to get my body back in shape. So.
To ask the guy yesterday, he goes, will these tablets make me sleepy? And he goes, no, but you can take these tablets if you want to feel sleepy. He goes, no, opposite.
Coming from sport, we know what can you do injured? You know, we know he can still go. I knew he was going to go.
He wasn't going to let anything stop him, even if he had to rock up on a wheelchair or, you know, have a cane.
As long as he can speak and move, he's going to go on.
Sasha is hit through the wall.
When I woke up in the morning, I felt healthy.
I think he was feeling a tiny bit better.
I had the best sleep.
But his coughing was terrible.
If we thought he was going to, like, cough into a judge's face or into a coffee or whatever and croaking to the judges, and we were just like, oh, no, like, this is really, really bad.
That was our biggest fear.
He felt horrible and he looked horrible. You know, we all suggested do not do training run. But it didn't go like that. He decided to do full-on practice run.
I actually just personally needed to show up to the venue. Everything else was organized by a team. Even though when I was dialing the shots, when I was tasting coffees, I've tasted nothing. Semi-finals was dedicated to my entire team. Because they've tasted, and they've said, hey, this is what we're tasting, this is what you should say.
Now I need to stop talking to everyone for 2 hours so I can have my voice.
We just hoped he accumulates enough energy for 15 minutes performance.
I hate to say it, but this is the 12th competitor in the semifinals for this.
The moment he walked out on the stage, I was just 2 meters away from him with Betty, just hoping he doesn't collapse.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sasha Sestik of Australia.
Oh no.
That was too loud, wasn't it?
If he keeps coughing to routine, we can't call technical timeout.
The last 4 years, as a barista and a coffee buyer, I've met so many.
He did everything really slow and spoke to the judges half speed and took, I think, 15 seconds longer.
My consumers, which is you today, I needed to do a lot.
I was getting that feeling that he is so close to start coughing, and I was like, oh my God.
Camilo grows many exotic and rare varietals at his farm. And for you today, I'm serving Sudan Rumé.
We always had a saying in sports, the moment you're on the court, you're not injured. If you are injured, and if you decide to play it, you're not injured. You're out there, you play.
Can I have a time check, please?
He cut some parts short, realized running out of time. He missed out one or two details.
He got to a signature drink. I think he spilled a little bit when he unscrewed his blender top. And some of that was going all over his board. He was cleaning that up and was behind time, and we're all just like, move.
So guys, I would like you to enjoy this drink in two sips.
He somehow managed to get through it. I don't know how. He's so strong mentally.
Making the presentation that he made in that condition gives to his performance even more value.
So please enjoy it. Time.
Please give it up for the barista champion of Australia, Mr. Sasha Sestik!
Nerve-wracking. I can tell by his music that he's behind time.
Whew. And our first finalist and the first competitor tomorrow, from France, Charlotte Merivale! From the United Kingdom, Maxwell Colonna Dashwood! From the United States of America, Charles Babinski!
They'd called out number three and we were all starting to freak out again. Hida's just like, no, it's fine, he's gonna be called out next.
Next to Sasha.
From Australia, Sasha Sestik!
I think he came through as number three, which was still impressive being that sick. It was a good, solid moment of proving yourself, yeah.
Thank God that come finals day, he was feeling 85% better than what he was.
It's still a bit croaky, and we're like, no, you're almost normal. We decided to use a better roast of his cap coffee. It was smelling amazing, so he was like, all right, we'll chuck this through first. ran the shot and was like, yeah, this will be good. Let's just taste that. And it was just like one of the best milk bases I've ever tasted in my life.
Amazing.
This is raspberry candy.
Man.
And then Sasha was like, yeah, cool, we're done. And we're like, you don't want to try your other one? And he's like, no, this is good. We'll just do this. We're like, okay, let's do espresso. He poured one espresso and was just like, yep, that's better than yesterday. We're done. That espresso was, it was like sherbet acidity. It was like sparkling, like mixing tartaric with citric with sugar and then dried apricots. And it was an amazing espresso.
They are so good.
We look back and every time we try a new coffee or a single origin, we go, were they as good as WBC finals day?
Here we are. After all these months, today is the day.
I was a little worrying about today's things right before this practice, but boom, blew my mind. I don't have to worry alone. And
much more better.
Much, much more better.
Much, much more better.
The champion of Australia, Mr. Sasa Sestik!
As I was looking around the crowd, I said, well, yeah, it's my time to shine and it's my time to sort of introduce myself to specialty coffee world best way I can.
Okay, so shall we have music, please?
Right from his first sentence, and it is really good to be here. You could just see that he was ready to do it, he was focused.
It is really good to be here with you again. So in last 4 years, as a barista and also coffee buyer, I've met so many wonderful producers.
It's the only time I've ever, in the entire time being with Sash, that I've actually managed to watch him and feel like he's in full control. Yeah, goosebumps watching him.
So guys, coffee I'm serving today is from Camilo Marisande from Colombia. He built this unique greenhouse system to protect these coffee trees from UV rays. We managed to get 4% more sugars in this system comparing with the Latino common shade. And that's what's gonna give you more sweetness in your espresso.
He was talking, looking at them, making eye contact whenever he could. While he was grinding, he was looking across, are they okay? It was brilliant. Like, he was the least nervous guy in the room.
Our processing is very unique. And that's because we call this process Bosched Carbonic Maceration. And I drew my inspiration from winemakers.
I've never seen him deliver something so passionately and so controlled and like, this is my stage sort of thing.
Lately, I've been loving this very fruity, natural process cappuccinos. So what I've done is I blended 50% of natural processed Sudan Romain with 50% of Bosch carbonic maceration process. So when I combine this milk with my espresso, you're gonna get very creamy mouthfeel. Raspberry candy and hint of white chocolate. I think this coffee is just delicious.
Seattle, let's hear you take the roof off for the cappuccino!
When he got to the signature drink, we're like, all he has to do is just finish this and he's done it.
He was in control. If one of the judges dropped the glass, I think he will catch it on there. He was that much into it.
So back in Australia, in a local winery, I've done carbonic maceration with the wine grapes. I've pressed them in a stainless container. Then I moved the container to below 5 degrees just to make sure that we don't produce any alcohol. We ended up with this amazing liquid. When I add 5 milliliters of this Shiraz grape to 4 shots of my espresso, you're gonna get these amazing raspberries.
He wasn't just running through the process, you know, he generally wanted to get his message across to the judges and tell them about this coffee and what he'd done.
I've selected the black plums, which I have reduced with a panela sugar, just to highlight that stone fruit sweetness of my espresso.
I've also slightly heated this reduction just to emphasize the aromatics. I'm adding 10 grams of ice. I'm gonna put this entire drink through this high RPM blender that's gonna give us that nice creamy texture.
believe it or not, I actually watched all six competitors. I thought, it's not because he's my husband, but come on, like, he nailed it.
I would like you to enjoy this drink in two sips. So in the first sip, you're gonna get this amazing creamy mouthfeel. But then in the second sip, we're looking for sparkling acidity, raspberries, and the stone fruits. I believe that relationship between a farmer and consumer plays new but very important role. And my inspiration to work with Camilo is because I, as a barista, wanna serve you an amazing coffees. So on behalf of Camilo and myself, please enjoy. Thank
you. Let's give it up for the barista.
I've actually clapped to myself as well. I was just emotionally happy. This was so good.
Sasha Sesti!
I knew that this is the best presentation I've done ever. Regardless, finished number six in the finals or number one, I knew that this was my best shot and I could not possibly do anything better than what I've done in the finals.
Yesterday, our top 12 semi-finalists competed, and this afternoon, our top six finalists also completed their routines. And right now, we're getting ready to announce our champion.
Now we come to the business end of the things, and somebody's going to win.
It's time to get some baristas out here, I think, because it is a barista competition.
I'm stressed.
So in the order that I competed today, please will you put your hands together for the barista champion of France, Charlotte Malavant!
Of course, any one of those six can win. I think Maxwell's third time in the final, top six. Sasha's first for him. You have to look at who he has to beat to win. It was scary to hope.
It's either gonna be all the way on the top, or it's gonna be number six, because maybe there was this big mistake that I haven't noticed. And I had a fear of that big mistake because I've done something similar here before in Australian Barista Comp.
And then they started.
In sixth place, the barista champion of...
Let's hope it's not Sasha. Let's just get through six and be okay.
France! Charlotte Malavant!
After, you know, they announced Charlotte for number six, I actually had a bit of breathing space. I felt that I might be somewhere in the top three.
In fifth place, the barista champion of the United Kingdom, Maxwell Colonna Dashwood! In fourth place, the barista champion of Hong Kong, Dawn Chan Kan Hu!
Somehow number four happened without even us realizing that Sasha is still standing there. And the moment you turn around, it was top three. It was Charles Babinski, Ben Putz, and Sasha.
Congratulations, guys, first of all, on making top three. And in third place,
you just hope it's not Sasha.
The barista champion of Canada, Ben Putz!
So when they announced Ben Putz is number three, this is when I freaked out. Absolute, completely, like I just had this energy going from my thoughts to my head and this excitement and scare and cold sweat.
I was feeling so sick. I just so wanted him to win.
I was just, you know, shaking like when you are minus 20 degrees.
It was Sasha and Charles Babinski.
This is So close.
And they decided to call, obviously, number two first.
In second place, the barista champion of...
And they paused for ages. Oh, come on, like... It was just like waiting for what was to come next.
Couldn't say it any slower. The barista champion of... And he's standing there and goes...
The United States of America, Charles Babinski!
A little bit rude, all of us, because we jumped out of joy. We didn't wait for announcement to say that Sasha actually won.
And I'm thinking, is this a dream? Am I World Barista Champion?
And the winner of the World Barista Championship 2015, Sasha Sesti!
Seeing Hire coming over with the trophy, and I just hugged him. I could not stop hugging him. I think poor guy probably had a bruises. Thank you.
Zube da pravu bol zaboravim.